स्टैंडर्ड 12th सब्जेक्ट फिजिक्स, थर्ड चैप्टर काइनेटिक थ्योरी ऑफ गैसेस एंड रेडिएशन। फ्रॉम दिस चैप्टर लेट अस सी द प्रेशर ऑफ आइडियल गैस, दैट इज वी हैव टू ऑब्टेन द एक्सप्रेशन फॉर द प्रेशर एक्सर्टेड बाय द गैस ऑन द वॉल्स ऑफ द कंटेनर। इन ऑर्डर टू ऑब्टेन दिस एक्सप्रेशन लेट अस कंसिडर एन मोल्स ऑफ एन आइडियल गैस be enclosed in a cubical box of volume phi equal to L cube. So this is the cubical box having length of its each side equal to L, so that its volume will be equal to L cube, and in that cubical box n moles of the gas are enclosed. Now the temperature of the walls of the container are kept constant, that is equal to T. The gas molecules are continuously moving randomly in various directions, colliding with each other as well as with the wall of the box. Hence, they will bounce back after colliding with the walls of the box. Now, the intermolecular collisions, that is the collisions between the molecules of the gas, will be neglected, and we will consider only the collisions of these molecules with the walls of the box. Let us consider a molecule of mass m moving with velocity v towards the shaded wall of this box. When it is traveling towards this shaded wall, it is traveling along positive direction of x-axis, and hence the velocity component along x-axis, that is Vx, will be considered as positive. Now after collision, this Vx, that is x component of its velocity, will be bounced, which it will be altered so that it will be taken as negative. As it is traveling along positive direction, Vx will be taken as positive. When it is rebouncing, that is traveling in the direction opposite to that of initial direction, it will be taken as negative, and hence the component Vx of the velocity will get reverse, keeping the components along y-axis and z-axis, that is Vy and Vz, unaltered. Hence for all the molecules, their average y and z components are not changed by collision of these molecules with the shaded wall of that cubical box, and therefore there will be change in momentum of the molecule only in the x component of the momentum. And hence we know that momentum is nothing but the product of mass and velocity, and therefore in this case, when that molecule is moving towards this shaded wall and collides with it, before collision with this shaded wall, it is moving with velocity Vx and its mass is m. Therefore, its initial momentum, that is before collision, will be equal to m Vx. But after collision, the velocity component Vx is reverse, and therefore it will be taken as negative, and hence final momentum, that is after collision, the momentum is minus m Vx, and therefore we can calculate the change in momentum of that molecule, that is delta Px, will be equal to final momentum minus initial momentum. Now that will be equal to minus m Vx minus m Vx, which will be equal to minus 2 m Vx. So this will represent the momentum or the change in momentum of that molecule. Now the change in momentum of the wall, that is shaded wall of that container, will be nothing but it is the momentum transferred by the molecules to the wall, and which will be equal to plus 2 m Vx. So this is the change in momentum which is gained by the wall, that is shaded wall of that box, and therefore it is plus 2 m Vx. Now If you consider this change in momentum, after that, now when the molecule is rebounds, then that molecule goes to opposite wall and collide with that opposite wall. Again, this molecule will rebounds and collide with this shaded wall. Thus, between these two walls, that molecule will travel continuously, and thus the molecule travels a distance of 2L in between two collisions with the same shaded wall. And then the average force exerted by one molecule we will have to calculate. So as this molecule collides with this wall, again it will go back towards this opposite wall so that it will cover distance equal to L. Again it will come back so that it will again cover a distance equal to L, and therefore the average force exerted by any molecule one on the wall will be given by Newton's second law of motion as average rate of change of momentum of the molecule one. Here we have considered only the first molecule, a single molecule, and therefore we will get the average force by that molecule one as the change in momentum of that wall divided by the time taken between two successive collisions with the same shaded wall, and that is will equal to 2m vx1 upon 2L upon Vx1. So that will be equal to M into Vx1 square upon L. So this is the average force exerted by molecule 1. Now if you consider other molecules such as 2, 3, 4 and so on with their components of velocities Vx2, Vx3, Vx4 and so on, then the total average force on this wall is given as the average force will be equal to M by L into phi x1 square plus phi x2 square plus 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 and so on, so that the average pressure P, the average pressure P will be given as the average force per unit area of shaded wall. That is, the average pressure will be equal to average force upon area of the shaded wall, so that we will get the average pressure P equal to M into phi x1 square plus phi x2 square plus 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 and so on upon L. That will be the average force, and it will be divided by the area of that shaded wall, that is L square, so that we will get the formula for pressure P equal to M into phi x1 square plus phi x2 square plus 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 so on divided by L into L square. And now we know that the mean square velocity phi x square bar, mean square velocity phi x square bar is given as phi x1 square plus phi x2 square plus 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 so on divided by n. And therefore from this phi x1 square plus phi x2 square plus plus plus, this term will be having its value n into phi x square bar, and therefore putting that value of this phi x1 square plus phi x2 square plus 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 so on in the above equation, we will get the average pressure P equal to, that value will be mn phi x square bar upon phi. Now in this relation, this phi represents the volume, and this v x will represent the velocity component along x direction. But if you consider this as average velocity, that is phi square bar, phi square bar, that will be given as phi square bar is equal to phi x square plus phi y square plus phi z square. So this is in general the average of squares of the velocities, that is mean square velocity phi x square plus phi y square plus phi z square. And by the symmetry of that cube, we can write phi x square bar equal to phi y square bar equal to phi z square bar. So along x, y and z directions, if you consider it, then its value will be equal to 1/3 phi square bar due to the symmetry of that cube. And therefore, the average pressure will become equal to 1/3 n by phi m phi square bar. Now in this relation, 1/3 n by phi m phi square bar, this equation gives the pressure exerted by that gas on the walls of the container. Now from this relation, again we can proceed like this. If you take the product of nm, that will give you the mass of the gas, and therefore this equation can be written as 1/3 m by phi into phi square bar. But m by phi will be nothing but the density of the gas, and therefore pressure p equal to 1/3 rho phi square bar. So this is regarding the pressure exerted by the gas. Now let us consider root mean square, that is RMS speed, that is root mean square velocity or RMS speed. In order to obtain the expression for it, the pressure exerted by the gas is given as P equal to 1/3 n by phi m phi square bar. And therefore, from this relation, we can write phi square bar equal to 3PV upon nm. Now, by using ideal gas equation, we can write PV equal to nRT for n number of moles of the gas. And therefore, as PV is equal to nRT, we can replace this PV in the above equation by nRT. And therefore, we can write phi square bar equal to 3nRT upon nm. But n upon n, if you consider this n, this small n is equal to n upon na. And therefore, 3nRT upon na into nm. So in this case, small n is replaced by n upon na. That will be written as 3RT upon m0, because nn will get cancelled here, and therefore we will get 3RT upon m0. Now in this formula, small n is n upon na and m0 equal to na into m. So this is the mass of the gas, which is the product of na and m, where na is Avogadro's number. And therefore, if we take the square root of this above equation, that is phi square bar, so that we will get RMS speed, and therefore phi square bar under root, that is square root of phi square bar, will be equal to square root of 3RT upon m0. So this equation gives the RMS speed, that is root mean square speed of the gas molecules. And therefore, from this relation, it is clear that as R3R upon m0, all are constant. Therefore, RMS speed of the gas molecules is directly proportional to square root of its absolute temperature T. Now, if you compare this relation for RMS speed for sound waves, and therefore for the sound waves, we have the formula square root of phi square bar equal to square root of gamma RT upon m0. Now, if you compare this equation with this above equation, where gamma is equal to Cp by Cv, that is the ratio of specific heat at constant pressure to the specific heat at constant volume, whose value is 5/3. So here it will be 5/3 RT upon m0. Here it is 3RT upon m0. And therefore, from this relation, we can conclude that the sound waves cannot travel faster than the average speed of the gas molecules, because here that gamma equal to Cp by Cv, which is less than 3, because its value is 5/3, and therefore the sound waves cannot travel faster than the average speed of the gas molecules.